Are you paranoid or dealing with self-destructive behaviors such as sleep disorder, anger issues, drug and alcohol abuse? These are possible symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder or other traumatic experiences. The General Ibrahim Atahiru Foundation presents Campaign Against Suffering in Silence, CASIS. CASIS provides professional mental health, psychosocial support and non-judgmental services to serving and retired military, paramilitary and their families. For more info, call 091-2795-0177. Again, 091-2795-0177. And log on to our website, www.atahirufoundation.org. On Instagram is at @Atahiru_foundation. Twitter at @TIA_foundation. Facebook at @Atahiru_foundation. YouTube at @Atahiru_foundation. The General Ibrahim Atahiru Foundation, promoting mental health and social well-being.
Nigeria. Good morning to you. On the flip side of the radio, it's the program CASIS, the Campaign Against Suffering in Silence, on the third day in the month of February 2023. It's good to have you once again. You know, on CASIS, we bring to you information at the right time. And I always say, getting the right information at the right time is key. So once again, welcome to the program, CASIS, the Campaign Against Suffering in Silence, from the General Ibrahim Atahiru Foundation. Yes, it is a program. It's all about, you know, mental health and psychosocial support for the military and paramilitary personnel, those who are suffering from PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, and other traumatic situations. So if you find yourself in this category, or you know someone, you know, associated with you or related to you, your friends, your family, you know, anyone around you, you feel, you know, this person is not acting as normal as the person should. This person, you know, always wants to be alone, you know, always wants to just want to be alone. You're going through stress, you're going through issues, you know, even work related, then know this is the right program for you to be on. Like I said, it's every Friday, 10 a.m. on the dot. And today we have Dr. John Umogbai, a mental health practitioner, on the show today. And of course, we'll be having your questions and your comments. And don't forget to join us live on Instagram at @officially_shanti. @officially_shanti. And the number you can call in to be a part of the program, like I said, to drop your comments and ask your questions, is 08063963643. 08063963643. All right, Good morning, Doctor. It's good to have you on the show today.
Good morning.
Okay, and yes, going straight up to the topic of today. You know, we've been having series and, you know, additions and, you know, giving information to people, you know, on what PTSD is. So, for someone who is just joining us today, what is PTSD? Post-traumatic stress disorder.
Post-traumatic stress disorder. As we have always been talking about, and not just to bother us, is a condition where an individual is affected by previous events or occurrences that have been stressful to them.
Yeah.
Usually, the thinking is usually about harmful situations, which now makes them begin to have certain symptoms that are stressful to them, ranging from anxiety symptoms relating with stress, sometimes depression as well, and a cascade of symptoms. And this takes a lot of time, giving them very undue experiences that are not enjoyable to them, affecting their sleep, affecting their functionality during the day or even at night. And they find it difficult to cope with daily living.
Okay.
And in the long run, everything about them is affected. Some of them now even begin to try and isolate themselves. Some of them try to cut off from society. Some become aggressive in a bit to cope. Some of them decide to, you know what, look for other unhealthy means to try and cope with it. They go into substance use. Some start abusing different substances, psychoactive substances, smoking alcohol, marijuana, name it, and a whole lot, just so that they can cope and try and get some relief. And so it involves a whole lot of that, just to put this in summary.
All right. Okay, now, talking about post-traumatic stress disorder, how can someone, you know, aside, you know, the issues of life, you know, work-related, what other things can actually lead to someone, you know, going into PTSD, you know?
Okay, there are several lessons that can lead to it. For some people, even a harmful relationship.
Okay.
Like rape in early years. Even not in early years. Some people experience an accident. Some may be in areas where you have wars or areas of unrest, or even experiencing kidnap or a family member going through that. Or some may even be in an unhealthy relationship, an abusive relationship. These are several things that can lead to PTSD. Bullying as well.
Okay.
Even for children. Bullying as well can lead to PTSD over time. So it's just something that what exactly creates that in an individual that puts them to that much stress that they're unable to cope or handle. That's what we're talking about.
All right. Okay, now I'm going straight up to the main topic of the day, the role of mental health for peaceful coexistence. The role of mental health for peaceful coexistence, yes. What are the roles, you know, of mental health, you know, for us to have a peaceful coexistence in Nigeria, especially, you know, this at this moment, you know, where the country, you know, going through a series of, you know, issues? How, you know, can mental health actually affect the peaceful coexistence of Nigerians?
You know, with mental health, we deal with how people think, how people feel, and how people behave, right? And that itself, like I had mentioned earlier,
yeah,
results in how the individual is able to cope with life, deal with the stressors of life, and even become functional in their environment and functional in their society and where they exist. How would you have a peaceful environment or a peaceful coexistence with somebody who isn't mentally stable or who is going through some mental health challenges? Such an individual is not in their right sense of, in their right senses.
Okay.
Poor judgments. They make poor judgments. Just like I mentioned earlier, people become aggressive, people become irritable. How do you now maintain peaceful existence or coexist peacefully with that individual? Coexisting with someone means you're sharing same space with that individual. You're letting that person into your life, and also that person's also letting you into their own life and experiences.
Yeah.
Right? Now, when you have someone who is not able to deal with theirs because they are going through some mental health issues, then I think it becomes very, very difficult to actually even say it. So, the The truth is this, especially when we talk about areas of unrest or where you have issues in the society,
okay,
the effects of that lead to mental health issues for a lot of people.
All right.
Not being able to deal with it, anxiety, depression, and all of that. And then people now can no longer function appropriately. Even with the economic situation where there's no money and all of that, and then you're having people now going through depressive situations and depressive states.
Okay.
A lot of symptoms, people tend to withdraw. Apart from the fact that sometimes people become aggressive.
Yeah.
Right? How do you now be in peaceful coexistence with such an individual? And that's at an individual level.
Yes.
Now let's escalate this. If I were to ask you a question, if someone hurts you today,
yeah,
is there a possibility that you would have that in mind if such an individual does not apologize?
To forgive. You,
to forgive in 3 months' time. Is it possible?
Okay.
It's possible. Okay. That such an individual will have you in mind and will still hold on to that hurt.
Yeah.
What would the relationship with the person be? How would you perceive such a relationship? How would you want to coexist with such an individual?
Yeah.
So mentally, when people are not in that space, right, their individual functionality affects the functionality of the community as a whole. Mm-hmm. Remember when I was talking about what mental health is, I was saying that the individual is able to function and contribute,
yeah,
to their existing society. So yes, you cannot separate the mental health of a population, of an individual of a population, right, from them being able to coexist, yeah, without conflict.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Like you said, you can join in on the program right now. You can dial the number 08063-963643. Drop your comments and ask your questions. Don't forget, we still have Dr. John Umogbai, a mental health practitioner in the studio, and we have been talking about the role of mental health for peaceful coexistence. Yes, Nigerians, you know, we have been going through a lot this period. So what are your thoughts? What do you think we can actually do to be able, you know, to have a peaceful coexistence? How do you think we can actually build our mental health? Because like I said, people are going through a lot, and it has been, you know, plunging people into anxiety and depression. All right, back to you, Doctor. You know, talking about anxiety and depression, are they correlated, and can they be, you know, formed into PTSD? Like, if someone is going through, or has depression, you know, or going through stress and anxiety, are all of them, you know, on the PTSD?
It's just similar symptoms.
Okay.
Right? They're all conditions, different conditions. But in the condition of PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder,
yeah,
you have symptoms of depression in that condition. You also have symptoms of anxiety in that condition as well. So there are overlapping symptoms. I'll give you an example, malaria, typhoid. Both conditions have fever.
Okay.
Both conditions would have headache.
Headache, yeah.
Yeah, but there are different things that would...
entirely.
Yes, okay. There are specific things that would differentiate them. But yes, they share a lot of time, right? You have them... coexisting together. So sometimes in an individual with PTSD, they may even have an overlap of both anxiety and depressive symptoms, and it would even look like a mixed case of mixed depression and anxiety disorder.
So in other words, someone who is, you know, suffering from PTSD, you know, really, really has to seek help, because it's something that has to do with both anxiety, depression, and stress. You know,
absolutely,
all, you know, intertwined together. All right, so for let's talk about, you know, the, because this program, you know, is actually targeting soldiers, you know, the military and paramilitary personnel, you know, and their dependents, their wives, their families, their relations, and all of that. So how do you think their mental health can actually, you know, affect, you know, especially when they've gone, you know, back from the front line, and they actually meant, you know, to come back into the society? How do you think this can actually relate with the way they coexist with their families, first of all, before even talking about the society?
Okay, thank you very much. That's a very good question.
Right.
Because that has always been the issue. It's the expression of PTSD,
yeah,
when they return.
Yes.
That's really what we're talking about. What really happens, right, is when they come back, they're unable to cope. maybe to relive most of these experiences. Imagine someone butchered in front of you. Imagine someone who was captured and tortured
for weeks
and months. No, even the individual
themselves.
Imagine the soldier who had gone through all of that, right? Who's not, and then is unable to sleep during the, is unable to sleep at night, probably gets just a few minutes sleep at night.
And having nightmares,
right? How do you think they were able to exist in the house? Some of them get irritable, get aggressive. The brunt of that is passed on to their loved ones, right? Some of them go into substance to try and cope with all the symptoms that they're trying to deal with. Sometimes they can even become so severe that some of them even have some psychotic experiences. They start hallucinating.
Even suicidal thoughts.
And suicidal thoughts. In cases where the symptoms of depression are very severe, or even ideations, what happens is that the family, right, and those who are with this individual get to feel the brunt of it.
Mm.
If the individual is aggressive, who do they turn on? They turn on their closest family members. They beat them up.
Wow.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Where they can't manage their resources and their funds, who suffers it? The family members, they're not able to take care of them anymore. Some of them even isolate. They leave the house and then just go into substance. They start drinking. They go into a whole lot just so that they can cope. Because they can't sleep, they are looking for things that will help them sleep. Start taking substances like codeine, tramadol, and a whole lot, right? And then the family begins to try and see how they can help them, but they can't help them. The weight of all of this, right, is now on the family. Someone who is going through a mental health condition, the family bears most of it. And they now begin to suffer what we call caregiver syndrome.
Wow. So caregiver syndrome.
Yeah, so those who care for the individual who is going through a mental health condition, they themselves get stressed.
Okay.
They themselves get... So let's look at it. The delusions, right, are probably projected towards them. Oh, my family members want to kill me. But they're the ones trying to care for them.
Yes.
They're the ones showing them love. They're the ones spending all their money running around and trying to see how they can help them.
Yeah.
Right? They go through the stress of get beaten up. They go through the stress of being ignored. Because when individuals start isolating themselves and socially withdrawing themselves, they also do that from the family members. Imagine you can't talk to your husband. Or you can't even talk to your wife. You've not had
good communication
for months, in a long time. You want to try to have it, there's an outburst. What's going on?
Okay.
You understand? So it affects the family to start with. So they feel the brunt of it. And then what now happens is the family members now also now start trying to look for ways they can cope. Some of them now go into substances as well, get introduced to substances as well. Some of them begin to suffer depression. Some of them start having anxiety. Daddy is coming.
Everyone is scared, agitated.
Everyone is scared. What's going to happen next? Right?
Yes.
Mommy's coming. What's going to happen? She's going to break the TV next. She'll do this. She'll do that. She's going to beat you. She's going to take a knife now. What's going on? So everyone is living on the edge. Everyone is scared. They're scared for their life as well. Imagine living in that state. A lot of times people don't know what's going on in the home because we try to protect this, the individuals in the family. They try to protect this from the outside world.
Yes.
They try to contain
stigmatization, you know.
Because of stigma, exactly, and all of that. But what do they do?
Yeah.
What can they do about it? Right? Mm. We're not even talking about the individual being able to function with other people in the community.
Yes.
And you can see it's already spreading. Family members affected, they too.
Go out to the community.
Exactly. So it starts from that unit and it spreads from the individual to the family and then it keeps spreading. At the workplace, they can function as well. And then the family members in their respective workplaces as well cannot function appropriately. They're being affected. Some get to lose their jobs. Some are no longer productive at work. And they get queries over and over again.
Yeah.
Some of them are getting sick and getting ill over and over again. It may just be psychosomatic symptoms, not necessarily illness. So they're having repeated ulcers, they're having repeated malaria. They go and do tests. Doctor is saying, results are coming out and saying, you're fine, but I'm having ulcer pain, I'm shaking, I'm having a high blood pressure, getting high blood pressure. So a whole lot begins to happen and everything just goes into
plunges.
Yeah, just plunges into a big decline.
All right. Thank you so much, Doctor, for that one. All right. We are still on the topic, the role of mental health for peaceful coexistence. And if you just tuned in, absolutely, you made the right choice. You are on the program, Causes, the campaign against suffering in silence, from the General Ibrahim Atahiru Foundation. Like I said, we are live on Facebook, on Instagram at officially_Shunti. And we have been joined by Cole on the me underscore Freya. We also have Mariam underscore Amma. We have MJ Hair Palace also joined in, and BRJ Music just joined in right now. Like I said, you can ask your questions and drop your comment on the number 080-6396-3643. Okay, let's see. We have a call. Hello. 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 All right, we lost the one. Please do call back or you send in a text message. Let's see. We have a message here. This one says, good morning and thank you very much to the doctor in the studio. I want to ask a question. Please, how can a family member help a military personnel who is going through PTSD? All right, yes, doctor, that's for you. You know, how can a family, because we're just talking about family members, you know, how they are being affected by all of this and how it transcends, you know, to the life of a military personnel. So this person is asking, how can a family member, you know, help out?
Get the individual for treatment.
All right.
Yes. It's a medical condition, it's a clinical condition, and it's treatable. So the individual should see a mental health professional and get the proper treatment. I wouldn't advise that you treat the individual at home. Mm. That's the best help you can give, and let the professionals do it the right way.
All right. Okay. And that's why we always say tune in to 107.7 every Friday, 10 a.m. for the program Campaign Against Suffering in Silence. If you can hear that, Campaign Against Suffering in Silence. Yes, you know, like I said, a whole lot of people right now are going through different issues ranging from anxiety, depression, stress, even PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. It's something you might not have taken note of, because it's what is always said, that even people who are suffering from this might not even be aware. But you know, as a family member, as you know, wife, husband, friend, you're noticing your friend, you're noticing your husband or your wife, you know, always wanting to relegate him or herself, always want to be alone, you know, you're having difficulty sleeping, you're always getting angry, you know, and all of that. Know that you need help, you know, you need help. And, you know, it's just at your fingertips. That's why I said always get the right information at the right time. And like I said, you can still join us right now on 080-6396-3643. 080-6396-3643 to join us on the conversation. And the topic is the role of mental health for a peaceful coexistence, the role of mental health. And you know, we've been getting, you know, a lot of comments from people saying, yes, you know, it's the program, you know, is coming at the right time where Nigeria is going through a lot, you know, especially even with the bank, the money, you know, not being able to withdraw, you know, even from the bank, from the ATM, the POS. I just hope that, you know, very soon everything will be put in place and, you know, we go back to our normal activities. Because even this alone, you know, just in one bank, I saw where a woman actually stripped herself naked.
Yeah,
if you actually check, she might even be going through something, you know, because it's not normal for someone to just start putting off your clothes, you know, and going half naked, you know, in the presence of everyone. And so such person, you know, might actually need mental health evaluation.
Absolutely.
So a lot of people actually walk the streets, but you don't even know that they are going through stuff. So it's always good for you as an individual, you know, to take note of persons around you. And, you know, it's always good for you to call and know how people are faring. So, doctor, quickly, let's talk about the factors, you know, and that promote peaceful, that can actually promote peaceful coexistence.
First of all, let's take care of ourselves. You can only give what you have. You can't give what you don't have.
Absolutely.
Right? So, if we ourselves are okay and we're at peace with ourselves, then we can actually now transmit that. Mm. Being okay mentally, comes with also being emotionally intelligent, being able to show empathy, being able to relate with the other individual and accept them for who they are, and they accept you for who you are. So let's take care of ourselves first and foremost. Let's pay attention to our mental health. As we have learned today and we have been listening today, it's very, very key for peaceful coexisting, especially in conflict. Mm-hmm. Right? So that's one very important factor. Let's be able to communicate
effectively.
Yes, communication is very, very key.
All right, let's say, Dr. Wilson, we have a call. Hello? 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 Oh, no. Please keep trying. 08063963643. 08063963643 is the number you can call in and join us on the topic, the role of mental health for peaceful coexistence. What do you think? You know, what are your thoughts? What do you think can be done, you know, for us to have a peaceful coexistence? Talking about mental health, especially for our military and paramilitary personnel. What do you think can be done to help them out? You know, they are the people who are at the front line, you know, trying to keep us safe and sound. And don't forget, we also still have Dr. John Amogbai, a mental health practitioner, right here in the studio to take your questions. All right, let's see, we have a message there. This one says, good morning, I am Mr. Johnson. Thank you very much for this program. I have learned a lot this morning. And kudos to the military for their job. All right, thank you very much, Mr. Johnson, for that one. Okay, yeah, Doctor, you were talking about factors that actually promote. You said take care of yourself and... You also mentioned
communication. Okay. Let's break the culture of silence.
Okay.
And that's a big problem in our environment. We go through things, we're going through hardship, we're going through things, and we're not talking to each other, we're not speaking to ourselves, we're not communicating. Without communication, we can't have dialogues.
Mm.
And without dialogues, we can't resolve issues. And in resolving issues, then we can actually resolve conflicts and be in peaceful coexistence.
Yeah.
Those are very, very important. Right?
Yeah.
Amongst other things, the availability of things, just what you mentioned. There's also a rule where you can't make things can't be absolutely difficult, and then we're expecting to just keep on putting on our shock absorbing garments.
Okay.
There's so much an individual can take. People would break down under that stress. Mm. And when they do, they react. And that's what happens. So we need to put things in place. We need to be sure that people are able to live the basic amenities, things for survival, food,
made readily available.
People shouldn't have money and they can't get something to eat, right?
Yeah.
What's going on now? We're beginning to exploit each other.
Mm.
We're no longer behaving like human beings should behave. Why? Because there's an undue scarcity of what's in existence.
Yeah.
Right, our purchasing power, the naira notes, it's scarce, so people can't, and that's why we see the reactions we're getting out there. Right, so people are being pushed to that extreme, and then we begin to exploit each other, right, and begin to extort each other. And how do you imagine someone would feel where they don't even know if they can have their next meal because they can't have access to the funds to be able to get a meal? What would that do to them mentally? And they're worrying about it, and they have children. Their kids don't want to know how that's going to happen.
Happen, yes.
The individual is beginning to break down. Anxiety is setting in. It's getting depressed.
Mm.
1 day, 2 day gone.
Nothing.
And it doesn't look like the situation is getting worse. So we need to have certain things in place. So the salient issues need to be resolved. Safety is also very important.
All right, safety.
Yeah. Safety is very important. Right. We can't be living on the edge. You can't expect someone to be living on the edge and expect him to sleep.
And you know, when you can sleep, when you can sleep well, you know, with your two eyes closed, you could actually even have this stress and plunge into depression.
Yes, it can result in a sleeping disorder, which itself affects your mental health or affects the individual's mental health. And then we're dealing with something else altogether.
Mm.
The individual gets cranky, there's just a whole lot of decline, a lot of things in the quality of health that can go wrong. So there are several factors that you and I know and we experience every day to actually help us, right? Let's ensure to eat well. But then how do we eat well? We need to solve those issues.
Yeah.
We should eat well. We should take care of ourselves. Right? When we feel something is going wrong, mentally, changing behavior, changing thinking. Some people say, I can't even think well anymore. I can't concentrate. That may just be a symptom. It's a very common symptom in many mental health conditions.
Okay.
I can't concentrate. Looks like I can't remember things properly.
When you're forgetful.
Yes. They're easily being forgetful. Appetite changes.
Okay.
Sleep changes. It could be too much. It could be too little. Appetite could be too much. Appetite could be too little.
Yeah.
Right?
And even for people who overspeed, you know, when you're driving and you're overspeeding, then you should know there's a problem, because it's not normal for you to be driving above the speed limit, you know. Then you should know, you know, you also need help. You need a mental health evaluation. And I think that's already in place in Lagos State, where when you're overspeeding, you know, they think you put you through mental health evaluation to know if you are okay. So this, just like you mentioned, but a few the factors, you know, that promote peaceful coexistence. All right, we'll be wrapping up shortly. Doctor, just before we go, your final words, you know, and for the role of mental health for peaceful coexistence for anyone who just joined in right now before we wrap up the show.
Very important. Let's take care of our mental health. We take care of our mental health, then we'll be able to coexist with each other. It's only one who can think properly, can feel properly, and behave properly that will be able to coexist or exist with you
properly. Absolutely.
I'll wrap it up with that.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Dr. John Omogbai, mental health practitioner, for being on the show today. And, you know, the network is really bad, but thanks so much to all those who were able to connect via text messages. We say thank you very much. To join us same time, same station, next week, Friday, 10 a.m., on the dot for the program, Casts, the campaign against sovereign end silence, from the General Ibrahim Attah Hero Foundation. And thanks to all those who also joined us via Instagram. We also had Fiery _ also joined in. Thank you very much. Like I said, join us same time next week, Friday, 10 a.m. I remain your host, Thelma Okukun. Have a good Friday.